Everybody, and welcome to this earnings call. We have with us Mr. P.S. Reddy, MD and CEO, Mr. Bharat Seth, CFO, and Mr. Nilesh Kutur to discuss the results. I would request Mr. Reddy to give us a brief overview of the quarterly results, post which we'll open the floor for Q&A. Over to you, Mr. Reddy.
Thank you, Mr. Agarwal. Welcome to the conference call, analyst call of CDSL. And this year, we have done exceedingly well, as you have seen the results. Apart from the quarter, the overall year has been good. Capital markets are booming, and the new issues have substantially lifted our revenues. Mr. Bharatbhai will tell you the revenue heads, which have substantially contributed. And at the macro level, our market share is now 46.5% as at the end of the financial year, as against 44% in the beginning of the year. And that's a substantial gain that we have made. And in the current year, in the last year, we have opened 25.72 lakh accounts, as against the competition 15.11 lakh accounts. The incremental market share is gone up to 63%, so that has lifted the aggregate market share. The CVL also has substantially contributed to the growth, and I was, it's almost 30% of the, you know, top line at this point in time. 1 minute.
90%.
This is 19% of the top line and 23% of the profits that's contributed. And in terms of CVL KYC, we have about 1.7 crore KYCs, fully digitized, available, and people are using it. And what is important is the multiple uses of the KYCs has resulted in substantial income. That's one part of it. The second part of is eKYC is doing well, and a lot of online account opening is happening using the eKYC. Of course, there is some rough patch that we are currently going through because of the KYC. Aadhaar should not be used, and then the matrix matrix subsidized. So until that final issue is finally decided by the Supreme Court of India, probably there will be some slow process of approving applications. But otherwise, it's doing well. The other part of it is the National Academic Depository. Here again, we are a market leader at this point in time. And the number of academic institutions which have signed up with us are 231 as against a competition 190, and we have 47 universities or academic institutions additionally given a letter of intent. So we are setting up their whatever the integration part of it. Once that is done, they will also sign up. And when it comes to the commodity repository, which recently we launched, of course there is no great income. There is no income except the investment income at this point in time. It's in launch sometime in September, and there are about 72 repository participants we have registered so far, and very few accounts have been opened, and the ecosystem is still being developed. We are conducting a lot of awareness programs with the warehouses, with banks, with commodity traders, and we see a lot of mandis where the major mandis where the various products are being traded. So the response has been very encouraging. That's one another important thing that we have done. The other part of is SEBI has granted the registration for registrar to the issue. RTA license, we got it, and that we will be starting shortly. There's also news you must have read in the papers also. The unlisted companies are also going to be admitted with the depositories, because then only the government or the Ministry of Company Affairs will get a complete view about what's happening in these countries with respect to their shareholding. That process is also, discussions are on, And, you know, that's another line of business that we are looking at it. Of course, will not be as big as the listed companies' revenues. Obviously, there won't be much transfers. You know, that's one important thing. We are also looking at another important piece. Thanks to the online account opening, there is an e-sign project. So for doing e-sign, you need to be, you can work with somebody who is a certifying authority, or you yourself can become a certifying authority. So we are currently working with Encode. There is another branch of GNFC, which is a certifying authority. So we thought there are only four in this space, and we too should be doing well by entering into it. Maybe going forward, online e-signing will take in a major shape. But then we should be there in there when it is really big. That's why our board, especially the CVL board, has decided to take up that activity as well. Initially, we don't expect any great revenues, but then only time will tell how far we will do it, how better we will do it in that space. That's the e-sign part of it. So these are the major developments in this space, and there is another thing that the board has decided was to, last year we had issued about 30%, this year it is decided to declare a 35% dividend, that is 3.3 rupees 50 paisa per share dividend. That gives you a dividend payout ratio of 57%, which is by and large maintained the last 3 years. That's what we have been doing it, and then that's maintained, 57% dividend payout ratio. Now I will ask my colleague Bharat Chet to speak on the financials.
Good evening, everybody. On consolidated results on annual basis, first time we have crossed total income of 225 crores, means more than 200 crores we have crossed, and first time we have crossed on PAT after, means profit after tax of 100 crores, it comes to 103 crores as such. Increase in operational income by 31% and increase in expenditure by 20%. Whereas profit before tax is increased by 21% on consolidated basis, whereas PAT is of a 20%. Whereas on standalone basis, first time we have crossed 150 crores turnover operational income. And profit before tax, first time we have crossed 100 crores, that is 106.38 crores as such. So my standalone basis operational income increased by 27%, total expenses increased by 14%, and profit before tax increased by 16%, whereas profit after tax is 14%. On quarterly basis, if you see Q4 versus Q3, on consolidated basis, is more... towards operational income is more or less same, that is 1% increase is there, but other income has increased by 67% quarter 4 versus quarter 3. Whereas total expenditure increased by 13%, profit before tax increased by 4%, and net profit by 2% as such. And on standalone basis, operational income quarter 4 versus quarter 3 by 2%, and other income increased by 55%. Other income means income from mutual fund as such. And total expenditure increased by 10% quarter on quarter basis, whereas profit before tax increased by 6% and profit after tax by 7%. So I would... Consolidated basis as well as standalone basis, I have told. So I would like to open forum for question and answer.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to only use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sanjay Latta from Perfect Research. Please go ahead.
Hello.
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 Hi, sir. Good evening, sir. My first question is... Yeah?
Go ahead.
Hello. The depository services being offered seem to be similar across competitors. What strategies are we deploying to get incremental market share?
Well, to get incremental market share, the online account opening is one thing that we are concentrating on. And we are looking at, more and more admitting more and more DPs and more and more, fintech firms. And, if they become DPs, obviously they will be able to ramp up our account opening faster than anybody else. That's the way we are looking at it.
And the second question is, you described that unlisted companies also have to register. Could you please elaborate how this process works?
No, MCA is considering asking the private limited companies and others to admit their securities mandatorily, okay? And once that mandate takes a concrete shape, obviously they will be asked to dematerialize the entire shareholding into depositories. Now they may choose one of the depositories. We don't know whether they will mandate it with both so that investors may have an accord with either of the depositories and still they get serviced, or they may say that no, you go only with one of them to reduce their costs. And obviously the cost will not be, or the tariff will not be as high as what SEBI has mandated the listed companies to pay. Mm-hmm. So to that extent it will be much lower than what it is.
Okay. And because the last question from my side is, what is the addressable size of opportunities at present?
Come again?
What is the addressable size of opportunities?
Of these unlisted companies?
From the services we are offering.
What are the other opportunities available like that? Addressable opportunity.
What are the addressable opportunities? Look,
addressable size of opportunity, as like how much the total size of the opportunities we are gathering. As like in FMCG, they are 1,000 crore market share, and footwear, they are 1,000 crore industry. So as like what we have, what is the addressable size of
that? We will not be able to, share anything of those things. That's not appropriate for us to comment.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. From my side. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Nitin Agarwal from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Thank you for giving an opportunity and congratulations on a good set of numbers. Sir, my first question is regarding the recent news where SEBI said panel headed by R. Gandhi is likely to recommend allowing new corporate houses or private companies to get license for depository services. So I wanted to know what is the status on this, and if allowed by SEBI, then, how will the competition pan out in the next 2 years?
See, we thought two itself is a crowd in the depository space. If the third one comes, I don't know what to say on that. But then, as we said, I don't know what the Gandhi Committee has actually said, because nothing official has come out as yet on this. It's only newspaper reports.
Yes, right.
That discussed in bits and pieces. So we will see and then evaluate strictly what the Gandhi Committee has said, and then what the competition, what we should do to withstand the competition. Having said that, my view is that there is not enough space for too many depositories to work in this space, because the depository participants have to incur expenditure, and the product is by and large homogeneous, and the market is, especially the ones the established players are already tied up with either NSDL or CDSL. So even if a third one comes, then the depository participants have to tie up with the third one. And there's an expenditure at their end. Whether they will be willing to look at that expenditure, I don't know. I don't think so. That's a viable option. Okay, at this point in time, that's what our thinking is. But then we will see how it will pan out. Now, but there's no immediate danger in our view.
Okay. Thank you. And my second question is, if you could give us the revenue bifurcation for FY18 for annual issuer charge, transaction charges, IPO, corporate action, and online data charges.
Okay. Okay. On consolidated basis, annual issuer charges, FY17, it was 51 crore 71 lakhs. It has increased to 55 crore 62 lakhs, increased by 8%. Transaction charges from 31 crore, it has increased to 44 crores, that is increased by 41%. Yeah. IPO corporate action charges from 16.5 crore, it has increased to 29.48 crores, that is increased by 79%. Whereas online data charges from 18.7 crores, it has increased to 29.18 crores, that is 56%.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anand Latta from HDFC Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Sir, if you can give some color, like how is this annual listing charges calculated?
See, annual issuer charges on two fronts, one on a slab basis or on a folio basis. Okay. For example, if share capital admitted is more than 20 crores, then we can charge them 75,000. For example, Reliance, if you take it, XYZ company is having 25 crores share capital, then I can charge them 75,000 on the basis of slab. But they are having a 10 lakhs folio with us, then I can charge 10 lakh into 11 rupees. Yeah. Whichever is higher, like that we are charging.
Okay, and this charges are standards across both NSDL and CDSL.
Yes,
mandated by SEBI.
Yeah, mandated by SEBI.
Okay, and in the case of IPO corporate action charges, how that is limited, sir?
IPO corporate action charges based on the number of folios as such, that is 10 rupees per folio we are charging, or minimum file size, 10,000 rupees per file, like that it is.
Okay. And how is the transaction charges being charged, sir?
Transaction charges from 4 rupees 25 paisa to 5 rupees 50 paisa depends on a volume of business given by the depository participant.
Oh.
And that is on debit transaction only, like mobile phone. Incoming is free, outgoing is chargeable.
Sorry, debit, I didn't got the last one, sir.
It is like only debit transaction we are charging, not...
So at the time of selling, only you have to pay the charge, not at the time of purchase.
Right.
Okay. And so if you can give, what is the number of company listed with the CDSL? Corporate?
At present, 7,539 companies are there, listed with us.
And this includes listed and unlisted both together? Or?
Yeah. Over. Both together, 10,628 companies are there.
10,000? Oh, with us?
Yeah, yeah.
Of them, 7,539 are listed.
Yeah, yeah. Like,
okay. Sir, if you can give also the revenue of CDSL Ventures?
CDSL Venture, yes. CDSL Ventures. CDSL Venture on an annual basis, as on 31st March 2017, operational income was 24 crore. It has increased to 37 crores, 51% increase in operational income. Other income means mutual fund investment income from 5 crore 40 lakhs to 6 crore 13 lakhs, that is increased by 14%. Whereas total expenditure from 6 crore to 10 crores, it has increased by 63%, whereas profit before tax from 23 crore to 32 crores. That is increased by 39%. And profit after tax from 17 crores to 24 crores. That is increased by 38%.
Okay. And sir, how much stake we have in this venture? Is it 100% owned by us?
Yeah, 100%.
Okay. Sir, in the CDSL venture, we charges on the basis of the KYC.
Yes.
Right. So, what is the basis of charge? Like, how do we charge per transaction, which are certain amount, like in the case of transaction charges?
No, here the per case per KYC usage, the charges vary. Similarly, when you create KYC, there is one charge, and when somebody uses the KYC, the charge is different. So that's the way it works.
Okay. So, how much could be charges per KYC user, and how much is the charges for creating KYC?
By and large standard, but then some of the intermediaries who are giving big volume, there is a discount also there. That's the reason.
Okay. So, if you can give some color, like how much KYC we could have created in FY18 versus FY17?
I'll tell you.
Creation is... 21,28,000.
Yeah, go ahead.
Around 22 lakhs KYC created during the year.
This is a new KYC created?
Yeah, during the year.
This is 22 lakh is the new customer which has come, or it is a, suppose a customer could have done KYC while one mutual fund and second, if he's investing in second.
New KYC.
Okay. Okay. So similarly, you could have a data of KYC users also. How much KYC users could have happened?
I see that is a bit confidential. We don't disclose that. Okay.
Okay.
Because there's a four other competition in the
competitors
up there. Yeah.
Who else are there along with you in terms of competition?
NDML, CAMS, CARVI, DOTX.
Sorry, NDML.
NDML.
NSDL.
NSDL data management subsidiary that is there.
Okay.
And CAMS is there, CARVI is there, DOTX is a NSC subsidiary.
Okay, DOTX also does the same.
Yeah, but we are the largest among all the five.
Okay. Sorry, just a small request. If you can give quarterly breakup of your revenue in terms of how much is the annual charges, IP or online data charges, it will really help us in analyzing it every quarter.
Every quarter you wanted that. But that is the format what SEBI has and companies like. Accordingly, we are.
You can give in a press release a breakup of the revenue, it will help us, sir.
Definitely, we'll look into it.
Okay. And, sir, when you say online data charges, how it is charged, on what basis it is charged, sir?
It is the same thing. KYC charges only, they call it online data charges.
Okay. Perfect, sir.
Thank
That's
you.
From my side. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Jain from Valum Capital. Please go ahead.
Sir, your revenue on Q on Q basis seems to be flat. Sir, what are the reasons for the same? And second question is, your interest income yield is so low against so much of investment. So, can you just bifurcate how much you are like earning interest and how much cash is like very idle?
About the operational income, it is flat. It depends always on the market and quarter to quarter. Quarter basis is a stable as such. If you see quarter 1, 2, 3, 4, it is more or less stable as such. And it depends on number of IPOs as well as corporate action on particular quarter. It varies accordingly. Mm-hmm. Regarding the other incomes, our yield, if other income as quarter to quarter, it depends on the, see our 90% of the investment are in mutual fund as such. FMPs are there, short-term funds are there. So, it...
Yes, sir?
Yeah. So, it depends on a NAV base because as per the index, we have to provide as per the NAV, whatever mark-to-market we have to do it. So, as on 31st December, whatever NAVs are there, if you see, and as on 31st March, it has increased. That's why investment. And compared to...
Continue. Hello.
So, there are two components. One is tax-free and one is taxable. Components are there in investment also.
Hello.
So, yield is approximately 8.18% has come. If you compare to last one, that is last year, it has to 9.69. Because investable surplus was, because we have invested in the property, so around 52 crores was not available to us because of that also.
How much amount is like available on which you earn interest income? I'm asking that.
Corpus. How much?
How much corpus is available?
Total 550 crores.
550 crores.
And on which you are earning how much amount?
8%.
8.1%.
8.1%
return. Mm-hmm. And sir, your some corpus is into the regulatory cash mandate. So, are you earning interest on that part?
That is whatever, sir.
No. Come again, please. What are you asking?
There is some regulatory mandate to like you for you not to maintain 210 crores this cash or cash equivalent. So
net worth requirement.
So are you earning some interest on that part also?
Yes.
This 550 includes that also.
Okay, sir.
Abhishek Jain, are you done with your questions?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in the conference, please limit your questions to two per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Prakash Kapadia from Anived Portfolio Management Services. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Congrats on a very strong revenue growth and crossing the 1 billion PAT number for the year.
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Kapadia, can you please speak closer to the phone?
Sure. Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. I was saying congrats to the entire team for the very strong revenue growth and 1 billion PAT figure for the year. We were 1 billion sales few years ago, so we hope this is very structural, and congrats to the team for that.
Thank you.
Sir, if I directionally look at the investment book, the share of non-current investments has been going up. So if you could give us some idea of the tenure or duration of the non-current book, and will this continue? Is this a conscious strategy at our part to avoid repricing of interest rate shocks?
See, our total investment, if you see, 90% are in the mutual fund, and out of which taxable as well as non-taxable, tax-free, we are invested in the bonds.
Right.
And for taxable things, we are following that most of our investment are on 3 years FMP tenure.
Okay.
So their capital gain tax benefit also will be able to take.
So this would continue in the near future, where the longer term or the non-current could see further increase also.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. So that will avoid the capital gain. Understood. That is helpful. And, investor protection fund, there has been an absolute decline in FY18 as per notes. Is that right understanding at my part?
No. Last year, investor protection fund includes, SEBI has come out in 2012, and in 2016 they have come out with the guidelines. So we have transferred whatever funds last year with interest on that. That is around 1 crore 60 lakhs we have transferred towards interest. So because of that difference only.
So optically the number looks lower this year.
Yeah. Otherwise, one-on-one basis, it are same. Every year we have to transfer after the board approves this, we have to transfer the fund to the trust.
Sure. And Mr. Reddy, you mentioned about the e-sign and the RTA license which was just approved by SEBI. So e-sign is what, more linked to DBT, and how does that work? If you could give some color, and RTA, how does life change for us, and what's the game plan on the RTA side? If you could give
SEBI is looking at distribution of around the the dividends, etc., by the depositories. You know, there's a concept paper also already, I suppose it's there on the city site. Okay.
Right.
And there's also thinking that the depositories should be able to do whatever little is being now done by RTAs, because the IPO process has become online and substantial work has been shifted online. And what is left now across the world, depositories are doing more and more of even the RTA process also. So keeping that in view, we thought we should step in and then prepare ourselves to take over that kind of responsibility, to take charge of that responsibility. When it comes to e-sign, see, account opening turnaround time has to be reduced substantially, and many of the brokers or DPs are competing with banks and others who have a 3-in-1 account opening portal. So for that, they are using the e-sign, they are getting all documents signed. Okay, and e-sign is based on Aadhaar number. Now, so each once you fetch an Aadhaar e-sign using the one-time password, then that can be attested on only one PDF document. Okay. So the more the PDF documents you have to sign, the number of times you need to do that, Aadhaar fetching is increased. So, but then again, the turnaround time, as I said, is substantially reduced from few months to, maybe few minutes. Mm-hmm. And the compliance costs are also reduced, because there's no doubt that whether it is signed by client or not signed by client, you know, all the dispute is eliminated. And
right.
audit trail is fully established. So it's a very, non-nuisance kind of process. That's why, we want to step into that as well. And it's not necessarily that we will use that e-sign process only for the account opening in here. If once I am in a certifying authority, this e-sign concept can be applied for anywhere, for any document signing, not just account opening with the depositories.
Okay. So tomorrow it could be extended.
You can sign the bills. You can sign any papers that any piece of paper, any document. Okay.
Understood. That is helpful. Thank you, sir. All the best.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Khadija Mantri from IIFL. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening, madam.
I just wanted to know market share with respect to increase in demat accounts, whether it has increased QOQ and YOY.
Well, I will tell you. You can. Year on year, it is 64% as against 59% last year. We have now, it's about 1 minute. Yes, quarter on quarter it's an increase, 60, 62, 63, 65. This is the way it has gone up. Okay. The average is 63.
Okay. And this quarter it was 65.
Yeah, the last quarter it was 65.
Okay, sir. Thanks. That's all from my side.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Sanket Goda from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
I just have a couple of questions. One was on non-depository services have shown a good growth. Just wanted to know details, how it has, just more granular details on it. And second was that how should one look at the impact of central KYC? And if this happens, is CDSL being paid for uploading the data?
The CDSL major revenues come from the KRA business. That is where the CVL is doing. And we have been telling, and even in the IPO document also, one of the risk factors is if CKYC is the only KYC that is to be maintained and the KRS have no role to play, then probably this will take a big hit. But then at this point in time, we have been successful in, living through this fear. And I'm sure we will continue to for some more time. That's what my view is, because there's a value addition that what we are doing in the KYC arena. There's no in-person verification when it comes to CKYC, and there's also the data that is entered is verified by our people in our operation site. They also reject some of the applications where the KYC is done wrongly. So all that value addition is not coming through in the CKYC, from the CKYC system. So we see that we will continue to do that. When it comes to the upload charges, yes, even we are giving the services to the intermediaries where they upload on the KRA, and then we will massage the data and provide the file that is needed to be uploaded on CKYC. And then intermediaries quietly upload that data into that. They don't need to, there's no extra effort for them to upload that. So that is where we charge a very small price for doing that kind of massaging the data.
Okay, so the charges would be very low, or you can disclose the charges, sir?
Very low. The charges for massaging the data are very low. But then for the KYC creation and then actually doing it on the CVL KRA portal, obviously they are competitive prices. So that's all I can say.
Okay. And just on the initial part of the question, non-depository services has shown good growth. So if you can give more details on it, it would be really helpful.
It is substantially CVL. 99% CVL, because other businesses are still in the case of CARL, it has not taken off. As I said, that the insurance industry is not as yet supporting fully the dematerialization of the policies, or they themselves are putting up on their portals the policies. And when it comes to the commodity repository, just started last year sometime in September. We are still making the stakeholders aware of the benefits of the insurance, the repository, commodity repository. And when it comes to the CVL, that's a well-established platform. And the National Academic Depository, one which we are doing it under CVL, but the MHRD has mandated that we cannot charge the academic institutions till the September 2019. So we are only bringing them into our fold, but the charge will start only in 2019, September onwards. So that's the way it is.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. That's it for my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ayush Khaitan from Prospero Finvest. Please go ahead. Apologies. The next question is from the line of Anand Ladda from HDFC Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Sir, if I look at our four major revenue line, annual charges, transaction, IPO, and online data, all four together is 160 crore rupee. And our reported top line for the full year is 190 crore rupee. So if you can give some color, like the balance 30 crore are coming from which area, sir?
Yeah, 1 minute. See, there are other charges like user facility charges apart from those five you mentioned.
Okay.
User facility charges are there, then settlement charges are there, account maintenance charges are there. E-voting charges are there.
E-voting is one other major contributor.
That is 4 crores what we have won. E-case charges are there.
Sorry. In
E-voting charges, 4 crores.
Yes. E-voting and E-case. What is that E-case, sir?
That is consolidated account statement. Electronically we are sending and physically also we are sending.
Okay.
Those are there. You want figures also? Then
sir,
we can
if you can give figures, that would be great. It's helpful.
Yeah, user facilities charges 3.4 crore.
Okay, this is an
FI18.
Okay.
Then settlement charges 1.6 crore.
Mm-hmm.
Account maintenance charges 2.88 crores.
Okay.
E-voting charges 4.1 crore.
Okay.
E-case charges 6.43 crores.
Okay.
Then document storage charges, that is a CVL thing, that is 5.28 crores.
Okay.
EKYC, it will come to 2 crores.
Okay.
These are the major.
And sir, what is the growth outlook on all of these charges, sir? If you can, sir, what is the basis of these charges?
Basis of charges, you will find out everything on our website is there.
Okay, and sir, what is the growth outlook on these other charges, all like e-cash, e-voting?
That for e-voting, there is a competitions are there, so it depends on that also. And e-cash charges, whenever transactions are there, we have to send to beneficial owner. So this depends on the number of transactions they have done, and accordingly they are sending. So growth and all depends on a market over there.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
The next question is from the line of Harit Shah from Reliance Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the call. Sir, I have a query. Do you have the data for, you know, the total beneficial owner accounts, gross and net basis at the end of FY18?
Yeah.
Gross and net.
We are having a data of net BO accounts. So, current year CDSL has 25,72,000 accounts they open against NSDL of 15.11 lakhs.
Right, so this is on a net basis?
All on a net basis.
Yes, it is on net basis.
Sure. Okay. And so around, I think last year the total figure was about 1.6 crore, I think, the total beneficiary.
Yeah, having a 1.7 crore.
Yeah.
And we are having a 1.48 crores.
Right. This is also net, right?
Yeah, net only.
Okay, sure. And secondly, understand? What is the total amount of depository participants right at the end of FY18?
Yeah. We are having a 594 depository participants.
Sure. Okay, just one query about this. So, what is the reason for the depreciation charges increasing so substantially and the your net assets? So I think
recently we have bought a new property, no, office premises.
Right. So, just this is a
because of that only, and furniture and fixtures and all.
That is the only reason, right? There's no additional nothing apart from that, right? Because that was, I think, part of your capex in any case, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I just want to get a clarification on that. Okay, and just one last question. What is the outlook for, you know, FY19 and on an overall consolidated level? I mean, obviously the market will you know, vary based on, you know, various factors, but the, you know, the overall, you know, outlook for the rest of the business, if you could just give some qualitative understanding. Thank you.
Well, you know, we don't see any problem in market being what it is today, okay? And maybe the elections may and then rain gods may throw some element of uncertainty. But otherwise, you know, economy is doing well. There's no reason why we shouldn't be doing well. As long as there is an opportunity in the economy, as long as the economy does well, company sectors do well, capital market does well, we are going to capture the market so much we can be confident about.
Right. Okay, and one last question on my side. What is the capex outlook for FY18? FY19.
It would be around 6 to 7 crores.
Okay. That's it from my side. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pritesh Chheda from Lucky Investment Managers. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir, I missed the CDSL Ventures revenue for FY18 vis-a-vis FY17. Mm-hmm. And when you mentioned online data revenue, that is that CDSL Venture revenue or it's a separate number then?
No, same thing. CDSL Venture Limited only.
Okay, so that you mentioned as 29 crores versus 18 crores last year?
Yes. Q4, no? operational income CDSL Venture Limited against FY17, 24 crores, they have won 37 crores.
Achha.
Out of which 29 crores from online data charges.
Okay, so CDSL okay. Ventures is 37 crores versus 25 crores.
Mm-hmm.
And the difference between standalone and consolidated is a function of CDSL Ventures, right?
Yes, yes.
There is no other company or
no,
subsidiary.
Operational income side, no. Okay. See, out of 191 crores, 154 crores from CDSL and 37 crores from CDSL Venture for operational side.
Okay. Secondly, I just wanted to take some update on the GSTN. What is the status there in terms of monetization, track revenue? What is the update on National Education Record Repository?
Yeah, on the GST piece, we have, you know, as CDSL has transferred its license, rather, CVL has independently has applied and CVL got it, and we transferred the business from CDSL to CVL because, you know, we have not got the permission from SEBI to continue this business in CDSL. And, you know, the projections that, I mean, the kind of outlook that we had for GSTN was very bullish at the time when we launched. But then the number of filings have come down and, you know, we have not seen as much traction as we thought we will get it. So, but still, we stay put in this business and then see what will happen as the time pass by.
So, what was the area, scope of area in this business? You were basically records keeper for...
No. We are providing an ASP service as well as, you know, we are a GSP. So, if we have an ASP, what you call module, if somebody wants to use that ASP module, then they can use it and then they can upload it independently without depending on anyone. And if you have an ASP module and you can connect yourself to GSP and then you upload it. So, that's the way it is.
Okay. Okay.
And this is on the GSP. And I think I have explained earlier the National Academic Depository. You know, the number of academic institutions that we have onboarded, about 231 have signed up with us and about 47 have given letter of intent as against the competition. And again, it is there on the UGC website. You can see who has done what, like it's a transparent way. And we have also been told, of course, it's a part of the agreement. We can't charge the academic institutions till September 2019. So there's no revenue coming at this point in time. But we are engaging with all the academic institutions to register with us so that we will be able to start earning something from September 2019 onwards.
What kind of costs are sitting in the P&L from these two business areas?
Less than one crore.
Put it that. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Parimal Methani from Prudential Investment. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for a call.
Thanks.
Yeah, hello.
Hello. Thank you.
Yes, yeah, I just wanted to know in terms of technology-wise, how do we upgrade the entire thing in terms of the CDSL with reference to a lot of new technologies coming and the intermediaries getting out of the chain? Do you see that as a threat to your business?
Technology.
Yeah, we don't see any threat to business. You know, we are also upgrading our technology. People usually ask me about the blockchain, you know, and on two, three occasions also I did speak about blockchain. It's not as yet the stable tech, it's not a stable technology as yet, and not too many developers are there, not too many applications are also there. You know, thanks to Bitcoin, it has become a popular talking point and flavor of the month, but then otherwise, it's not a mature application as yet. So even if, you know, one fine morning blockchain comes, there's hardly anything that they can do. You know, they have to come via the regulatory jurisdictions and systems that are put in place. And it's not just depository alone will do it. Even the depository participant should be compliant with that. And existing depository participants also to also have to tie up with the new depository, even if a new depository comes. They don't going to invest additional money in a new depository. So we are not worried about that point. And whatever changes that take place in the technology front, we will be able to keep pace with that or maybe stay ahead of the technology changes that competition may envisage or that may happen in this market.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thanks for that.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Jain from Vallum Capital. Please go ahead.
Sir, with how many insurance companies you have been tied up for perpetually for electronic policies? So can you just throw some light on the same and in how is CDSL is being placed over there?
Yeah, 1 minute.
We have about, we have about 22 insurance companies which have signed up, life insurance companies. And we have 15 non-life we have signed up with us.
Mm-hmm.
And there are 18 non-life which are still in discussion. There are two insurance companies which are again under discussion.
Okay. And how many are there which have signed perpetual contract with you?
There is nothing called perpetual contract or anything. They sign the contract and there is always a termination clause, isn't it? So all these people are doing, some of them are active, some are not active.
And sir, I earlier asked, you are saying that 8.1% is the bond yield that you are getting, right, on the bonds?
Return on investments.
Return on investment, 8.18%.
Okay.
Not on bonds. Altogether okay. Investment.
Okay. And can you just bifurcate that also, per se?
What means bond you own separate and...
See, yeah. As he said that 90% of our investment is in FMP.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, mm-hmm. The substantial revenue comes from that, not from the bonds or anything. How
okay.
Much is that? Tax-free bonds are there. There are a few tax-free bonds, but not a very big investment. How much is it?
100 crores is there, 8.18, so it comes to 7.7.
How much is there? Tax-free is 6.85.
Okay. And sir, can you just throw some light on the warehouse receipt market size in India and positioning of CDSL on the same?
You see, as I said that we have just started this initiative. We were told that the bank's pledge business at this point in time is about 60,000 crores. And there's a, there's a scope for 1 lakh crores. But then, these are all, different people saying this number or the some agency is there and which has put up some report and then based on that we are saying this. But then the ecosystem, most important stakeholder is the banks. And the banks are pledging against the commodities in the warehouses and they should... make it mandatory for them to pledge via the repository route. So the discussions are on and then they are, WDRA itself has engaged with them and hope that, they will be seeing merit in doing via the repository route than what is happening at this point in time.
Okay. And sir, last question from my side is like, how you see the progress is being done in the space for DMAT for all, sir, your last commentary upon the same? Like how far it has been gone, how the this negotiation has been, like, hello?
Hello? I'm sorry, I didn't get your point.
How much progress has been done in space for this DMAT for all?
DMAT for?
All.
All. Okay, single DMAT account for all financial assets, you are saying that.
Yeah, exactly.
No, the regulatory changes are yet to be announced. So once the SEBI announces those changes, then the other regulators will start, doing necessary things at their end also. So to begin with, it will have to happen at the SEBI,
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the last question from the line of Ayush Khaitan from Prospero Finvest. Please go ahead.
Congratulations on good sets of numbers, sir. Sir, first question is how many number of companies has shifted from slab basis to folio basis in our annual issuer charge as folio basis generates higher revenue? So,
See, out of total revenue of issuer charges, 17% of the companies will give me on a folio basis. It gives me 58% of interest, 58% of total income issuer charges, and 83% companies are on a capital base, that is slab basis. It gives me 42% revenue from annual issuer charges. Hello.
Hello.
The current participant has moved out of the question queue.
Okay.
I now hand the conference over to Mr. P.S. Reddy for closing comments. Thank you and over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for participating in the call. And thank you for your support also. There are a lot of you are invisible to us, but then I'm sure you have taken a keen interest in the company. And we will do our best to stay ahead of competition and then meet the expectations of all the investors. But ultimately, the markets decide what is that we get at the end of the day. So thank you once again. Stay invested. I'm sure, you're in good company. That's all I can say. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Axis Capital,